prompt to join 173 predecessors in bringing their thoughts and opinions on important public issues. At this time, I would like to introduce Dr. April Mason, our provost. Dr. Jackie Hartman, thank you. Dr. Jackie Hartman, chairperson of the Landon Lecture Series and chief of staff in the office of the president. Dr. Barry Flinchball, chair of the Landon Patrons. Dr. Andrew Bennett, president of the Faculty Senate. And I might add, professor of mathematics when he's not doing Faculty Senate business. And Carol Martin, president of the University Support Staff Senate. Jessica Van Ranken, K-State student body president. She's also a junior in political science. And Trenton Kennedy, K-State student body vice president and junior in entrepreneurship. I would also like to introduce the following distinguished guest in the audience, Regent Dennis Mullen. Is Dennis here? I don't see Dennis, okay. Brigadier General Patrick Frank, Deputy Commanding General at Fort Riley. Hi, Pat. Welcome. So as most of you know, if you've read the material, Admiral Haney is the commander of U.S. Strategic Command and is responsible for the global command and control of U.S. strategic forces to meet decisive national security objectives, providing a broad range of strategic capabilities and options for the President of the United States and Secretary of Defense. The U.S. Strategic Command is one of nine unified commands under the Department of Defense. Before his appointment, he was commander of the U.S. Pacific Fleet from 2012 to 2013. He served as deputy commander of the U.S. Strategic Command from 2010 to 2011. He also commanded Submarine Group 2 from 2006 to 2008 and Submarine Squadron 1 from 2002 to 2004. Along with serving as commander of the U.S. Submarine USS Honolulu, his other at-sea assignments include Submarine Squadron 8, USS Asheville, USS Hyman G. Rickover, USS Frank Cable, and USS John C. Calhoun. Admiral Haney's shore duties include serving as director of the Naval Warfare Integration Group and the Submarine Warfare Division. He was deputy chief of plans, policy, and requirements for the U.S. Pacific Fleet and served as congressional appropriations liaison officer for the Office of the Secretary of Defense and administrative assistant for enlisted affairs at Naval Reactors. A native of Washington, D.C., Admiral Haney is a 1978 graduate of the U.S. Naval Academy. He also earned a master's degree in national security studies from the National Defense University and a master's degree in engineering acoustics and systems technology from the Naval Postgraduate School. Please help me welcome my friend and Admiral Haney to Kansas State University.
Thank you so much.
Appreciate it. Well, good morning, and thank you, General Dick Myers, for, one, having me here, and for your leadership here at Kansas State University, and also for that kind introduction. Well, it's an honor to be here and introduced by an individual who's a truly remarkable leader. And as the former chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, led us through the beginning stages of the global war on terror and tirelessly advocated for transformation of the military and support for military personnel and their families. So I would like a round of applause for General Myers. You know, he's worked here. And I'm sure he's put a lot of passion and commitment to this university. But I was really thankful he came by to U.S. Strategic Command and was part of an ethics panel that we had there not that long ago. And it's another one of my favorite subjects. The business of integrity and ethics, I think, is so important to the business wherever your planet. I will also say that he is the only person that I've met that is a more avid Kansas State University supporter than one other person I know, and that's my executive assistant back there at U.S. Strategic Command, Ms. Valerie Meyer. Not related, but also a Kansas State graduate. She studied biology here, and she has been there much longer than my two tours, as she has been in that front office of U.S. Strategic Command for about six different commanders. So she couldn't bring her here with me because she's too darn important and I needed to leave her there. Well, I can thank also all the leaders that are here from a variety of different places, both working academia, as well as people like Dennis Mullen, Kansas Board of Region, Chairman of Steel and Pipe Supply, and of course, as was mentioned, Brigadier General Patrick Frank. Thank you for your leadership. As I flew in this morning, I looked at the beautiful Flint Hills surrounding this campus, and I was reminded of when I was first towed by my lovely bride, Miss Bonnie, that we were going to be stationed in near Omaha at Offutt Air Force Base in Nebraska. She asked me quickly, you know, what had I done wrong to be stationed so far away from the water? Well, after two tours in that Omaha, greater Omaha region, first as a deputy and subsequently as the commander of U.S. Strategic Command, I will tell you that my family has truly enjoyed our time there. And quite frankly, we're a bit lamenting our plight because I will have a change of command on the 3rd of November, and we will leave Nebraska to head back to home in the Washington, D.C. area. Because we've met so many wonderful patriotic friends and people there in that region. And quite frankly, you can really see the heart of the heartland of America through folks like yourselves that live here. So I'll have to report back to Miss Bonnie that here in Manhattan, I found a sea of purple, as I can see here on the front row. I also saw the magnificent Bill Snyder Family Stadium, and know many here are excited about tomorrow's homecoming game against the University of Texas, the Longhorns. So good luck in that endeavor. I hope there's a lot of strategic thinking and good associated execution of the planning to make homecoming an enjoyable event. It is truly a pleasure to be here with you and as part of this prestigious lecture series, now in its 50th year, and to share with you some of my thoughts on strategic deterrence in this 21st century. Today's complex and multifaceted security environment involves nation state and non-state actors that are challenging well-respected international norms and our democratic principles. Given that, our current and future leaders must be able to rapidly connect to and digest traditional and non-traditional reams of information integrated into historical and cultural models to stimulate critical thinking necessary to create timely operational and strategic options for national security decision makers. They must have the capacity to understand advanced adversary perceptions and apply the knowledge to developing comprehensive strategies and plans, and with an ultimate goal of increasing decision space for our national senior leaders. As such, I want to cover three things today regarding deterrence in the 21st century. First, our challenges. Second, how we at U.S. Strategic Command are addressing these challenges. And three, where we need to work together to continue to address them. And you are part of that. Every day, we see headlines pointing to our nation's efforts supporting coalitions in places like Syria, Iraq, Afghanistan, and other hotspots around the globe. As Commander U.S. Strategic Command, I'm concerned about all of these, but I'm particularly focused on five evolving challenges. Sometimes we call it 4+1. Russia, China, North Korea, Iran, and violent extremist organizations. Today, we, including 500 soldiers from the nation's 1st Infantry Division at Fort Raleigh, are part of an international campaign against violent extremist organizations and terror groups that are recruiting and operating across political, social, and cyberspace boundaries, seeking to destroy our democratic way of life. Given what we have witnessed in this past year in places like Paris, San Bernardino, Brussels, and Orlando, we must succeed in this campaign. Now, by virtue of the size of its nuclear arsenal, Russia poses an existential threat to the United States. They continue to modernize, and even though Russia faces some challenging economic sanctions. At the same time, Russia is building conventional military forces, investing in nuclear weapons, including those with tactical ranges, and is pursuing hyperglide vehicle technology. With the current news of Russia penetrating via cyberspace, our political mechanisms. Russia continues to engage in destabilizing actions in Syria and Ukraine, developing counterspace and cyberspace capabilities and conducting activities below the threshold of the international community's alarm, all the while declaring and recklessly expressing its willingness to escalate if required. Having said that, Russia must understand it would be a serious miscalculation to consider nuclear escalation as a viable option. Russia will not achieve the benefits it seeks. Moving on to the Asia Pacific, China continues attempts to advance claims over disputed areas, conducting unsafe intercepts in the South and East China Seas. It continues to invest aggressively in its military, particularly in capabilities, both conventional and nuclear, that allow China to project power and deny access to others, emphasized by its recent deployment of long-range surface-to-air missiles to the Paracel Islands. China is busy reorganizing its forces, having learned valuable lessons from watching the United States and our coalition partners, and is working to enhance their capabilities, particularly their strategic support forces. They are also pursuing conventional prompt global strike capabilities, offensive counter-space technologies, while exploiting computer networks. China has the world's largest and most comprehensive missile force, and has prioritized the development and deployment of regional ballistic and cruise missiles to expand its conventional strike capabilities against the United States forces and bases throughout the region. They continue to field an anti-ship ballistic missile, which provides it some capability to attack maritime capability in the Western Pacific Ocean, such as our aircraft carriers. Additionally, cyber operations from China are still targeting and exploiting U.S. government, defense industry, academia, and private computer networks. As the Director of National Intelligence, Jim Clapper, testified in March of this year, he said, quote, China continues cyber espionage against the United States. Whether China's commitment of last September moderates its economic espionage remains to be seen, end quote. China continues to employ a combination of government personnel, contractors, and loosely affiliated and ideologically aligned hackers, augmenting their capabilities and challenging our ability to attribute malicious cyber activity. These activities, coupled with China's lack of transparency, raise questions about its aspirations in the long run. Moving on to North Korea. Now, I noticed Dennis Rodman hasn't been connected to Kim Jong-un recently. Not sure what's going on with that relationship. But North Korea's coercive, irresponsible rhetoric and actions undermine regional stability. Though North Korea is not yet an existential threat to the United States, it remains the most dangerous and unpredictable actor in the Indo-Asia-Pacific region. Pyongyang's evolving nuclear weapons and ballistic missile programs and provocative behavior underscore the growing threat. North Korea continues to conduct nuclear test activities of grave concern to not just the United States, but the international community at large. Kim Jong-un and his regime have conducted an unprecedented 2 nuclear tests this year, conducting a total of 5 tests within the last, and with the last month assessed to be the largest one yet, violating international norms despite sanctions and the horrible conditions Kim Jong-un's population lives in. North Korea continues to expand its stockpile of weapons-grade fissile material and develops a is developing a submarine-launched ballistic missile capability. They also continue in their quests for a nuclear-tipped missile capable of striking the United States and the allies and partners, as well as launching satellites into space using ballistic missile technology. These developments highlight North Korea's commitment to diversifying its missile forces and nuclear delivery options at all costs. Just as other adversaries have gone underground and rely on mobile capabilities, North Korea has an arsenal of mobile missiles, even a submarine, and uses its diverse topography to conceal its capabilities as well as its intentions. North Korea's willingness to ignore the plight of the people yet undertake provocative actions against Seoul poses a serious threat to the region's stability and demands the international community's attention. As with Russia, North Korea must understand it cannot escalate its way to victory, and the United States will take actions to assure our allies in the region. Moving on to Iran. They continued involvement in the Middle East conflicts and development of ballistic missile programs and cyberspace capability also requires our attention. Iran's current ballistic missiles are capable of striking targets throughout the region, ranging as far as southeastern Europe, and they are likely to continue developing more sophisticated missiles with improved accuracy, range, and lethality. This past March, the U.S. Department of Justice charged hackers associated with the Iranian government with taking concerted efforts to target U.S. infrastructure with distributed denial of service attacks against U.S. banks, the U.S. Navy and Marine Corps Internet, and a dam in New York. Iranian efforts in the cyberspace domain continue to evolve. While it appears to be following the mandates of the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, we will need to continue to watch Iran closely and remain vigilant for any shifts by Iran to depart from this agreement and develop a breakout nuclear capability. As we look in the rearview mirror over the last year and extrapolate into the future, our global security environment remains dynamic and uncertain. Some nation states are developing and modernizing their nuclear weapons capabilities. Nuclear and non-nuclear nation states aspire to have or have demonstrated their ability to employ not just a variety of missile capabilities, but also cyber and counter-space and other asymmetric capabilities. We're also seeing our competitors and adversaries becoming increasingly more mobile, hardened, and underground. Other trends include advanced missile capabilities and use of surrogates to avoid direct attribution, some striving to avoid that threshold of international intolerance levels. Similarly, we can expect an increase in the number of nations who may wish to deny the peaceful use of space. Adversaries and potential adversaries are developing, in some cases, demonstrating disruptive and destructive counter-space capabilities. They are exploiting what they perceive as our space vulnerabilities, threatening the vital national, civil, scientific, and economic benefits to the United States and the global community. Each of these trends creates significant uncertainty, and altogether they require constant collaboration with our allies and our partners to monitor, prepare, counter, and defeat. The reality is that the strategic environment I've described is more complex. It's like a multiplayer chess game. Today, we must view today's threats in the context of transregional, multi-domain, and multifunctional. In other words, the complexity of securing our nation's peace is not contained within borders or stovepipe domains of specific areas of responsibility. So you might ask, given all that, what are we doing about it? Some question whether deterrence is still relevant in today's world. I assure you, it is. Our strategic capabilities are used every day to maintain strategic stability. Now, strategic deterrence is a complex subject that is foundational to global security. It depends on the situation, and one size never fits all. Yet, it is bounded in the understanding that no adversary can escalate their way out of a failed conflict. No adversary will gain the benefits they seek, and restraint is a better option. And if necessary, we will respond in a time and place and domain of our choosing. Any nation that thinks they can get away with a strategic attack on the United States of America or our allies must think carefully about their actions and potential consequences. Now, strategic attack is one that has devastating or catastrophic effects on our population. I think we can all understand the impact of a nuclear weapon and what it would have, but it's also important to understand that an attack in space, given our dependencies across the board, or cyberspace, can also have a strategic attack effect. Given all of these complexities and the interconnectedness of globalization, these strategic problems have global ramifications that require a comprehensive solution. So as a functional or global combatant command, U.S. Strategic Command has trans-regional responsibility that extends from under the sea all the way to geosynchronous orbit. While my 9 assigned Unified Command Plan missions include space operations, strategic deterrence and assurance, cyberspace operations, global strike, analysis and targeting, integrated missile defense and joint electronic warfare, combating weapons of mass destruction, and intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance. Now, these all may seem distinct and disconnected. When considered as a whole, they are complementary and also synergetic. Having each mission under U.S. Strategic Command is what allows us to address 21st century deterrence in a comprehensive and integrated manner. U.S. Strategic Command capabilities underpin the foundational elements of deterrence, affording the United States the ability to maintain strategic stability, a must in this dynamic and uncertain security environment, and particularly as we address prickly areas associated with our national security. U.S. Strategic Command is a warfighting command, and as such, we focus on delivering comprehensive warfighting solutions to other combatant commands. We work to understand deterrence mechanisms and to gain a deeper understanding of our adversaries or potential adversaries. We provide the nation with a safe, secure, and effective, and ready strategic nuclear deterrent force that is ready. We engage with the interagency and fellow combatant commands to facilitate resiliency in space and cyberspace, increasing deterrence, and in synchronizing these military efforts with other elements of what we call the DIME, diplomacy, informational, military, and economic levers of power. And we are also investing to sustain and modernize the associated capabilities. Now, some might think that our nuclear deterrent force is only about the triad of platforms, intercontinental ballistic missiles, submarines, and nuclear-capable bombers. Now, while these capabilities are necessary, our deterrence is much, much more than just nuclear weapons and platforms. It includes and requires a robust intelligence apparatus, a space sensing capability that provides indications and warning, along with land-based radars, national and nuclear command and control and communications, missile defense capabilities for rogue nations such as North Korea, conventional capabilities, verifiable treaties and comprehensive plans that link organizations in a coherent manner. Each of these depend on successful operations in the space and cyberspace domains. In order to ensure strategic stability, we must be able to quickly fuse together intelligence and sensed information, ascertain if it's an attack on the United States of America or an attack on one of our allies, a missile launch in a war zone, or an expected developmental test. And when required, we must move this information all the way up to the President of the United States when required to maximize his decision space. The communications mechanisms must be survivable and they must be enduring to ensure this assessment is not delayed, and again, to maximize senior decision maker space, also to connect all of our operational commands together in a seamless fashion. So it's interesting when we think back to the early 1990s and how we thought about space. Anyone who has read The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, which I'm sure is on this campus reading list, you might recall the description that, quote, space is big, really big. You just won't believe how vastly, hugely, mind-boggling big it is, end quote. Today, though, this characterization of space seems to be amiss. The truth is, in relative terms, Earth-centric space is quite small. Once thought of as a sanctuary, space is more congested, contested, and competitive than ever, and it's becoming increasingly vulnerable. Today, there are more than 60 nations operating in space, and we can only expect that number to continue to grow. Similarly, we can expect the number of nations who may wish to deny the peaceful use of space to also increase. I hope you get the picture of the interdependencies between space, cyberspace, missile defense, and our nuclear deterrent forces in ensuring strategic stability from a military standpoint. Our deterrent forces stand at the ready and are critical in a global security environment where it is clear that other nations are placing a high priority on developing, sustaining, modernizing, and in some cases, expanding their nuclear forces. Our readiness and modernization efforts are key to ensuring current and future strategic stability for addressing a range of crises we anticipate and those we do not. Some in this audience may be aware, while we are making progress, our delivery systems and our national nuclear command and control architecture, it's maturing. They have already been or will be extended decades beyond their original service life, and all must be replaced in that 2025 to 2035 timeframe because we've delayed their replacements. In our intercontinental ballistic missiles, our B-52 bombers, for example, and our Ohio-class submarines that are off doing the deterrence mission today, well, they were fielded back in the 60s, the 70s, and the 80s. By comparison now, and you might be surprised that me as a four-star, I drive a vehicle that is 13 years mature, old by auto automobile standards today. But in my opinion, it's a real spring chicken by our nuclear deterrence delivery system standards. Now the car that is still reliable, but it requires a little bit more maintenance to keep her that way. So needless to say, like our nuclear deterrent systems, my car has to have an impeccable maintenance record. Today, that extended service of our delivery platforms is testimony to the efforts and ingenuity of our predecessors, particularly those designers and engineers, maintainers and industry. But we are fast approaching the point where we have an effective nuclear deterrent force that can be at risk. To be clear, however, baseline sustainment won't meet future adversarial threats. We simply must modernize. Delaying the development and fielding of our current modernization programs, everything from space sensing, communications platforms, life extensions of our warheads, or ceasing to invest in the people who engineer and maintain and operate these systems will create an unacceptable increase in risk. Equally, if not more importantly, delaying will directly affect our credibility and ability to deter and assure, and that can detract from our non-proliferation efforts. Usually when I get to this point in the speech, I typically get the question, hey, Commander, can we afford this investment? And I generally reply, given the security environment and associated trends and the importance of strategic stability, can we afford not to? Today, maintaining our strategic nuclear capability costs about 3% of our total defense obligation authority. In the 20s to 30s, as we began recapitalization in earnest, that figure grows up to about 6 to 7%. Now, that's a modest price to pay for a deterrent capability against countries like Russia and others. I encourage our next administration to continue to support our current efforts. It reflects our nation's commitment to our deterrence strategy. If we are to meet future challenges, we must have a synchronized campaign of investments supporting the full range of military capabilities that secure our national security objectives. So, while I was pleased with the President's proposed budget for fiscal year 2017, I'm not pleased with the fact that we do not have an approved budget and continue to live with this thing we call continuous resolutions. As we look at having a credible strategic deterrent capability, understand that we at U.S. Strategic Command, we don't do this alone. I fundamentally believe we must have a holistic approach which integrates military effects with all of our instruments of national power. This requires a synchronization of what we call the DIME, as I explained earlier, diplomacy, informational, military, and economic levers, which together deter our adversaries and assure our allies and partners. The military piece, of course, I'm a part of. In other words, we must pursue a proactive whole-of-government approach to deter that includes our allies and partners in our efforts with ready efforts in all domains. Otherwise, we're just playing defense, and it's not just about defense. One must have offensive capabilities, and I'm sure tomorrow, and probably Bill Snyder's thinking about it now, that the best defense sometimes can have a hole in it, and it can't win the game by itself. So as Commander of U.S. Strategic Command, I have 6 priorities. The first is to deter strategic attack against the United States and providing assurance to our allies. The second is to provide the nation with a safe, secure, and effective, and ready strategic nuclear deterrent force. And third is to deliver comprehensive warfighting solutions. Fourth is to address the challenges in space and cyberspace with capability, capacity, and resilience. And my final two priorities are building, sustaining, and supporting partnerships, and anticipating change and confronting uncertainty with agility and innovation. Now, I want to focus one of these two for the remainder of my time here, because it's where I think we can work together to address the challenges I've laid out earlier. Deterring in today's multipolar world requires us to view threats across the spectrum of conflict, where escalation may occur by more than one adversary and can be transregional and multi-domain. Given all of these complexities and their interconnectedness of globalization, these strategic problems have global ramifications that, as I mentioned before, require comprehensive solutions. If in the unforeseeable event occurs and deterrence fails, we must be able to provide relevant options to de-escalate the conflict in our favor. That requires us to have a deep understanding of our adversaries and potential adversaries and know the range of strategic threats that each pose. We need to know how they think, how they perceive our actions and our messages, so that we can better anticipate and address developing situations. At U.S. Strategic Command, we aim to work seamlessly then with the other combatant commands across our federal government, with allies and partners, with the commercial sector, and with academia to apply the scope of the U.S. Strategic Command portfolio toward a synchronized pursuit of national objectives, building and sustaining and supporting partnerships so that we can better understand the strategic and the regional environment and successfully develop effective strategies. Similar to the way Kansas State operates with its military and veterans enterprise, by engaging a whole-of-university approach to education, research, and outreach. Building deterrence and assurance capacity requires talented people, whether they are serving in our armed forces, in our government, or as industry partners, as well as in academia. As leaders, we must ensure that we are developing the talent that will assume the mantle as the geopolitical landscape continues to change and evolve. I emphasize anticipating change and confronting uncertainty with agility and innovation because I believe sound decision-making requires thorough analysis to prioritize our activities with a flexible, agile, and of course, adaptable thinking. In my almost four decades of service to our nation, I have seen a tremendous amount of change. It is interesting, when I boarded my first submarine, our focus was on one threat, rather than the many I outlined for you today. We faced a specific nuclear threat. Now we face multiple actors with weapons of mass destruction, with nuclear weapons. And only seven nations were capable at the time frame of launching satellites into orbit. Today, more than 76 entities have launched almost 18,000 objects into space. Also, right before I entered the Naval Academy, I was a glorified key punch operator on a mainframe computer. What most of our young folks in this audience can't even envision today with our smartphone and superior technology at our hands. But with all this, we still have to be thoughtful as we go forward. Our country needs professionals that can think deeply and strategically, voice an educated opinion, coherently document those thoughts, and drive effective solutions. We need individuals who are willing to develop and stretch their intellect well beyond one-dimensional thinking. We need leaders who do not become static and who search for and recognize signals of change and then find connections and solutions that are seemingly impossible. We need chess players who can operate in a multi-dimensional environment with multiple activities taking place simultaneously on a board where they may not fully understand the rules by which multiple adversaries are playing. We must be able to maintain situational awareness of what matters and act where necessary. We need to inspire and develop the next Thomas Schelling or Henry Kissinger to address 21st century deterrence, assurance, and escalation control issues. You know what was neat about this job? I actually had two different times to sit down with the great Henry Kissinger over an hour each and really discuss and debate with him our methodologies today associated with deterrence. It's great to see that individual at his tender age, and I'll just leave it at 90 plus, that engaged, the number of trips he's made to Russia and China, for example. Our security challenges also require the integration of diplomacy, informational, economic, and industrial innovation. We still have much, much work to do. We must ask ourselves, how do we deter one without provoking another? Are we thinking about our actions from the perception of our adversaries? How do we communicate our intent and our resolve and readiness in this age where the speed of information is so dramatically faster than it was, for example, during the Cold War? The answers to these questions start with this institution, yes, Kansas State University, and with the people in this auditorium. Kansas State University fosters a high-velocity learning environment and helps to create leaders who not only understand the challenges associated with the world we live in today, but who can develop and apply solutions. Therefore, we need you. I am proud to count Kansas State University as a member of our Deterrence and Assurance Academic Alliance, an alliance built on a common community of interests focused on themes of national security, deterrence, and assurance designed to leverage expertise and research on these concepts and to encourage the development of dedicated professionals to meet the nation's need for future generations of leaders to address these challenges. I was really excited earlier this year when we were able to bring a number, you know, we have about 31 now academic alliance, higher level institutions that in this case came to U.S. Strategic Command. We ran a war game, same war game we ran at a classified level, at an unclassified level. And I won't tell you the difference between the results, but it was great seeing those intellectuals and their professors really dabble in this in a big way. I hope U.S. Strategic Command can count on this university's participation and leadership in this partnership, as well as our 2017 Deterrence Symposium. Well, in closing, I'm honored to represent all those who carry out the variety of missions assigned to U.S. Strategic Command and all here who support those missions. Having visited our space, cyberspace, missile defense, and nuclear deterrent forces across the globe, yes, all the way from the Middle East to all the way down to New Zealand, can't say how proud I am of this group of dedicated professionals, both in and out of uniform, that get the work done 24/7. They deserve our unwavering support. And once again, I'd like to recognize the participants in this room, from government, industry, academia, media, who are aggressively working solutions and supporting what we do for our nation and supporting democracy. Ladies and gentlemen, the goal of deterrence is peace. Peace is achieved through strength. Strength is all of us working together to prepare for this uncertain world we live in. Now, I'd like to salute first the students that are here or that are watching this. Whether you are studying agriculture, political science, engineering, biology, international affairs, I salute you for taking this endeavor seriously and learning as much as you can while you're in this environment. You never know where you will use this sometime in the future. I salute those of you that are part of the ROTC unit, both here, and I understand we also may have some Kansas University ROTC students here. Thank you for, one, volunteering to wear the uniform and to be part of the greatest military on the planet. I also salute the professors and the researchers. I was so pleased to read about Dr. Brianna Golf, for example, receiving this award called the Outstanding Service Civil Service Medal from the General Milley, the Chief of Staff of the Army here back in the middle of September. It's my understanding she launched this Institute for Health and Security of Military Families and does a lot of work in that area. So I hope she's listening, or you all will tell her how proud I am of her as the first Kansas State University faculty member to receive this award. I also was surprised to find here in the group the Associate Professor for Landscape and Architecture and Regional Community Planner, Ms. LaBarbara Wigfall. I've gone to church with her parents back there on the East Coast when stationed in the Pentagon. Pretty neat to see that connection here. But all of the professors associated with what you do here, very important, and just listening to the chair of the mathematics department talking about this textbook thing that's being worked here so that you can have more virtual textbooks without that high dollar cost that I know I'm paying for my young son who's in college as well. Maybe I need to get him to transfer. But for all those big red one soldiers at Fort Raleigh, close here, and deployed, duty first, for all those from the university, I would embarrass myself or you by attempting to wash-bosh cannonball, but I will say, go K-State. Thank you all for what you do in support of our nation. I fundamentally am a big believer, in addition to the military, the business of what we do in learning. Academia is a national asset for the United States of America. Thank you again for this invitation to speak, and I'm happy to take questions. Thank you.
Okay, the protocol for questions are there are microphones. Please announce yourself. We'll get to it in just a minute. Please announce yourself one question at a time, please, and try to make it brief because we have several people that would like to ask questions, it looks like, so try to keep it brief, and we'll take the first question over here.
Yes, I'm Colonel John Sheehy, retired colonel, U.S. Army. I have two questions. You hear about the high atmospheric blasts that would knock out our electronic systems in this country, and that would be very disastrous. Could you, or how much detergents is put on this? Do we need more money put in this? But that would be seem like it would be a pretty fairly easy thing to do in the coming years.
Well, first off, Colonel Sheehy, thank you for your remarkable service to our country in uniform. And thank you for that astute question. This whole business of what he's describing is an electromagnetic pulse that could be generated by a nuclear weapon, as well as some other technologies, that if you had that blast, it could interfere dramatically with all these digital things we carry around, as well as our electrical lines of power and what have you here. And it's something that was researched very deeply during the Cold War, and it's something that we continue to work and study and look at our resiliency, particularly in terms of our military equipment that must be able to withstand that in order to provide strategic deterrence. But having said that, I would say that's an area where I continue to challenge some of my the agencies that support us, such as the Defense Threat Reduction Agency, have them doing some work to further help us understand those effects so that we aren't taking for granted that earlier research and that we are continuing to work towards that capability where we need to have it. Clearly, it's unaffordable to have everything shielded from that effect. That's again why strategic deterrence has to work. You don't want to get into the red zone, which I would say in this case, where someone actually employs a nuclear weapon. Hope that was helpful.
One more.
Sir.
Wednesday night, it was revealed to the world by one of our presidential candidates about the 4 minute it would take to get going, our defenses. Was that thinking very strategically? I don't.
Well, I won't.
You probably can't.
I won't touch the election process here. I'll let it take its normal course. I would just say that we take very seriously every second of how much time, and you've heard me really talk about how important it is to be able to have the mechanisms in place, the deliberate planning already done, so that we can help shorten certain activities to maximize senior leaders, such as the President of the United States, time for cogent decision making. So my job and my team's job, and I would say other combatant commanders' job, is to work very hard to do just that, to maximize the time frame for that. So hopefully that too was helpful.
Can we lower the mic?
Yes. No, Jeff.
Okay. Thank you. I'm Jeff Morris, one of the university administrators. And when you flew in, Admiral, to Fort Riley, up on the hill, on the Flint Hill, there's a Cold War relic, which is an atomic cannon, which is capable of shooting a tactical nuclear weapon about 20 miles. Now, we're very grateful in Manhattan that that cannon is facing west, not east, and it's no longer in use. But I've read recently that there's certain actors among the list that you gave us of people that are considering tactical theater, developing tactical theater nuclear weapons that might be in use in maybe not against the United States, but against some another country. I wondered how that changes the calculus from your standpoint in terms of deterrence with the availability of those types of weapons.
Well, thank you. Maybe I should drive by that cannon on my way out of here. Take stock and inventory, but seriously, it is disturbing in terms of where we are here in the 21st century that nations, some that I didn't even mention here, when you look at what's going on between India and Pakistan and the developmental trends that they have today, that the one piece, when you really look back, and I sort of had a good bird's eye view when we were working the nuclear posture review, in the New START Treaty back in the 2009 to 10 timeframe where it was planted. The business of providing our insurance umbrella and having credible capability is really to also to help prevent others from wanting to go there. And, you know, as you can see, when you look back when I was more youthful, it's just the tens of thousands of nuclear weapons that were in the stockpiles facing Soviet Union and United States, you know, on an order of 30,000 each. I'm pretty proud of how far we've ramped down those stockpiles today. But we aren't at zero. And as the president said in 2009, you know, he said he had aspirations for the world to be free of nuclear weapons, but he said until we get there, we have to have a capability that's credible, safe, secure, and effective. So New START Treaty puts the operational level at about 1550 operational nuclear warheads. That's just one of the constraints. I won't go through all of them. But to your question, what the New START Treaty does not consider is those what we call non-strategic nuclear weapons or tactical nuclear weapons. These are things that don't have intercontinental ranges. So they aren't accounted for. And to me, that's the problem. So as we look downrange for further treaties, et cetera, those need to be considered. And now these treaties, the New START treaties between us and Russia. So it's disturbing when we see other nations modernizing and developing theirs. And in many cases, they are also developing tactical levels of capability. So it's very important that we continue full court press in all of our endeavors. That's why we have to have an effective capability while at the same time working to encourage the international community to not go there. But we have to be prepared because we aren't there. And as a result, this is something that I've worked with my team, one, to raise the bar, to war game, tabletop, and really understand implausible or unbelievable scenarios that we would not want to have to think about, but somebody does in order for us to be effective going forward. So sort of a long-winded answer to your question, but this is an area that continues to require our attention.
Over here on our left.
Hi, my name is Jordan Martin. I'm a junior in computer science and mathematics here at K-State. And I was just interested in your thoughts on the recent statements from the Philippine president on his separation from the United States and the effect that you think that might have on the stability of the region.
Well, thank you, Jordan, for that question. It was interesting reading the headlines and the news material that I look at every day and seeing some of those. But I always reflect back to my number of visits to the Philippines, particularly when I was commander of Pacific Fleet, and the work we did there, and the people of the Philippines, and recognizing that we have an alliance and a special relationship there. I will let the business go on. I can't tell you exactly what that president is thinking, but I do know that there are no official requests for us, the United States today, from the Philippines. We have had a special relationship, both economically with the Philippines for some years. There are a lot of programs that we work with them. I remember as Pacific Fleet Commander, I can't tell you how many times, just like here recently, destructive typhoons came across there and we provided support for that country. Or we run Pacific Partnership operations. This is where we take our hospital ship, the HMS Mercy, and have it coupled together with non-governmental organizations and go to places like the Philippines and support the people over there. Passionate people. And when you look at the roots of our history there, you know, walking sacred ground of Corregidor and just thinking about that battleground, for example, in that time frame. So there's a lot of linkages between us and the Philippines. So I would just say let's stay tuned to the frequency there and see what comes about as we continue this journey together as nations. To your point here of the stability in the Asia-Pacific region is a function of many things. And a very interesting part of the planet. And I will say our efforts to continue to support stability in that region are so important, which is why we, although it's sort of a bumper sticker label, of why we some time ago did what we called rebalancing to the Pacific and moved a lot of our unique capability associated with our armed forces at large out to that region. Thank you.
Over here on the right, please.
Andrew Bennett from the Department of Mathematics. You've mentioned the importance of both cyberspace and of having offensive as well as defensive capabilities. What are your goals for offensive capabilities in cyberspace?
Well, number one, as I mentioned, this business of defense and offense, you've got to really have some requisite capability, and particularly, and fortunately, when you look at cyberspace today, there's so many actors, criminals to nation states, non-state actors, even seeing how violent extremists are using cyber to recruit, to finance, to plan, and what have you there. As such, you know, in that case, in areas of hostility associated with Iraq, for example, you know, we have, and it's not some secret, have been chartered by the Secretary of Defense to, in fact, use all of our capabilities in that particular area. So that's against a declared adversary. And I won't go into specifics of what those capabilities are, but it's an important area here. It's interesting in my lifetime, as I talked about this cyber business, and I, having participated in things like computer clubs, yes, I was a bit geekish for you young folks there over time, but sort of looking at it strangely as I saw us coupling more and more and more and more and more things with it. So now it's part of our culture, it's part of the international community and everything else. So until we have something else, we got to work to make that a safer environment by which we operate in. And that's not just military, that's across the spectrum of things, everything from identity theft on. So frankly, I'd like to see more of a national campaign ongoing in terms of, one, raising the awareness of what goes on in the mischief lane of cyberspace. You know, I frequently go to young folks in all hands call and ask, who among you are cyber warriors? The words get gotten out over the 3 years in the current capacity, in the time frame, in the previous capacity as I did this, and now more and more as I go around, everybody raises their hand. But in the beginning, not so much. So it's an area that really requires us to have discipline and understanding. And with that, we have to be able to respond through the full spectrum of capabilities.
Over here, please.
Good afternoon, Admiral. My name is Austin Fannin-Still. I'm a graduate student in electrical engineering and a former officer on the USS Nebraska. I left in February of 2014, and we were getting ready to go into the shipyard for refueling overhaul. One of the rumors at the time was that when the boat came out of overhaul, they'd have four of the missile tubes welded up and just loaded with ballast as part of the arms reduction treaties going forward. My question there is, given the important nature of the survivable leg of the strategic triad, will we be looking at any further reductions in capability in that leg going forward, especially with the replacement Ohio-class submarines?
Well, one, thank you for your remarkable service, and also sea service and submarine service, and continuing your education. The as we look at our capability, and you all noted when I talked about me driving my 13-year-old car, I'm a very frugal person, and I really believe that we have to be efficient, effective, but mindful of the taxpayer dollars. So it's been sort of neat to be part of, over various tours, of working the requirements piece of what do we need. So we're talking here about the submarine, the SSBN, ballistic missile submarine leg of this triad of platforms. When we looked at that hard and where we are today, we used to have 18 Ohio-class ballistic missile submarines. We reduced that down to 14, and we converted the other four to what we call SSGNs, to do conventional strikes, special operating force operations, and what have you. We're in the process of refurbishing that Ohio-class, which, as I say, we've actually extended well past its design life. Designed for about 30 years, and we're running it out to 42 years. As mentioned during the treaties, part of this was reducing the number of tubes. But when you look at its replacement that's being designed, instead of 14, really working to have 12. And to reduce, actually, the number of tubes also associated with that down to 16. Again, how much do we need to have? in order to maintain strategic stability. And that sea leg is designed to submerge, disappear, and be our capability so that no one can think they can do a first strike and take it all out and not have to face consequences. So a very important part of our nuclear deterrent force apparatus. But again, very thoughtful, analytical approach to how much do we need as we look at the cost of the capability, but so that we can still be safe, secure, effective, and credible. So hopefully that's helpful.
And the last question over here.
Hi, my name is Joel Blankenship. I'm a junior in political science history. I would also be a major in Russian if we had one here. So I do readings of Russian media just to get kicks and laughs off of Russian propaganda, to also just learn about the Russian threat that exists today. And there was an article a few years ago posted or written by the their equivalent of the Chairman of Joint Chiefs of Staff as far as like the projection of where he sees warfare going in the future. One of those being information warfare as far as like in regard to how media is discerned. Now, within the United States, of course, we have the First Amendment and we should have like free press and yeah, but so we're not even gonna touch that. But as far as like how can we deter or like move to further project US interests in the area of information warfare? I mean, during the Cold War, we had Radio Free Europe to counter the Soviet Union's media advances, but how do we do that in the modern age where we have, you know, the various Russian information advances in that regard, if that makes sense?
No, very much so, and you're always thinking about what to talk about in your speeches, and that was one area I usually like to talk about, is the information domain. Today, it is interesting, and it's not just about Russia, but how information is manipulated on the blogosphere in a timely manner such that we have to deal with it as a nation, as part of the international community. It wasn't that long ago, and I remind folks in many audiences that we had that tragedy of that flight over Ukraine, MH17, that was shut down. And it was interesting, the misinformation campaign that ensued as a result. Once information is out on the blogosphere, it's interesting in how you confront that. And I would argue you got to do it in a timely manner, and you've got to be factual, and you got to avoid emotions. And the factual piece is very important from an integrity standpoint. As I look at our ability, and particularly the speed, not just of text information, but picture information, even in our war fights in Iraq, for example, the business of people moving bodies around to make it look like we've taken out more casualties than we actually did in our precision strike methodologies in some cases. So this is the world we live in today, where you can get a tweet, and the tweet doesn't necessarily mean that it's accurate, or it doesn't necessarily mean it's the whole story. So I would just say I'm hoping you're going to work on a thesis that while you're studying here, because this to me is part of the new norm, and we have to work aggressively on this. And we have to understand sometimes, just like in any confrontation, you're not going to get out in front of it. But you have to have methodologies and methods to make sure you can shore that up with the right information in a timely manner to make a difference. So this is a part of the brave new world, I would say. Information will continue to move faster. And as you Google things as students, I would really encourage you to do multi-source Googling, back that up by other research papers, back that up by some review of textbooks, and don't just take bumper sticker knowledge and then integrate that research into some thoughtful information that can be used by our national apparatus across all of our efforts of government. Very important area, I think, for the future.
Admiral Haney, I lied. That was not the last question. It'll be from our Vice President for Research, Dr. Dorhout.
Good morning, sir. Thank you for being here. Again, my name is Peter Dorhout. I'm the Vice President for Research. And you've spoken a lot about different aspects of deterrence and what goes into strategic command for preserving peace here in the United States and around the world. You also introduced us to the term dime. And the E in dime, of course, stands for economic. And can you tell us a little bit about your thinking and the strategies that goes into considering the economic impacts of what I would refer to as non-traditional warfare that may include things such as infectious diseases that impact tremendous pieces of our economy, particularly here in Kansas, livestock and other aspects of farming that can be impacted by diseases that could be brought into this country for clearly nefarious reasons. And in particular, I'll point out an important asset here on Kansas State University's campus, which is our Biosecurity Research Institute, that's focused on BSL-3 level diseases and BSL-3 level ag diseases. And the new asset that will be located here in Manhattan, the National BioAgri Defense Facility.
Well, thank you for that question. Nice softball to end on, eh? But a very important one. You know, when I was a Congressional Appropriations Liaison Officer, I got introduced a bit to a lot of our biological part of weapons of mass destruction. And it was also at a time frame where we had that anthrax scare in the U.S., in mailrooms, a couple other places. And to see what some of these BL2, 3, and 4 category labs really look like and the work that goes on there, I think is very important, and particularly in terms of just how much work is going on in some of these biological areas of genome development. I can't even pronounce all the different things. So I'm really proud of the fact that you have a biosecurity institute that is here. I think that's very important. When I say weapons of mass destruction, that's nuclear, that's chemical and biological. And hence, it's an area that we have to also continue to look at trends, and we are, with that combating weapons of mass destruction part of our mission area. We work with obviously the Office of Secretary of Defense, but work with a variety of different stakeholders. Usually culminate twice a year. We force ourselves to get all those stakeholders together in what we call a global synchronization conference in the DC area, classified conference. And it includes all the interagency so that we can, in fact, chew on some real ugly problems, such as mentioned over here. But this is, you know, the business here, when I say we have a multifaceted set of threats that we have to get at, there are no easy answers. We have to continue to invest to understand them. We have to study them. And we have to, the other piece of that job was just learning how long it takes to build, prove, develop rather, and prove an antidote will work. I mean, it takes a long time. So you have to keep working on this. Those are some other unthinkable areas. So really happy to, I also read a little bit about that institute before coming here. And as I say, I'm really proud of those effects, that work going on. I think it is also very important. And as you mentioned, the food chain and supply, water supplies, those kind of things, very critical to the business going forward. So thank you for that work.
So ladies and gentlemen, hold that just a minute there, Professor. Let me just, we thank you. the subject of deterrence got a lot of work done in the 20th century, but as we just heard, in the 21st century, it's perhaps even more important, certainly more complex, and certainly a lot of ambiguity, which Admiral Haney went over, I think, extremely well. And he does get paid to think the unthinkable. And all I would say is, I'm glad we have someone so thoughtful that is there thinking the unthinkable and ready to advise our national authorities in times of strategic crisis. So thank you very much for what you do day in and day out, and thank you for being here at K-State with all of us today.
Thanks again for the opportunity. Thank you. God bless. Thanks for all you do.